Welcome to another episode of One Idea Away, where we're committed to living more fully, deeply, and consciously. Why? Because when we do, we're calmer, we're clearer, we're more connected, more joyful, and much more alive. On this show, we bring you stories of those that are figuring it out just like us, as well as experts who can shed light on the hows and the whys all of this stuff works. So I want to thank you all for tuning in and sharing and reviewing our show. If you haven't done so yet, please drop us a review. Also, subscribe to the podcast on our feed, whether it's on iTunes or whatever app you happen to be using. And if there's something that stands out in the show, do us a favor. If it makes you think of somebody, share it along, because this show is meant to get the conversation started, not just to drop in for a little inspiration. So with that, let's turn to this week's episode. Finally, it's finally here. And today I get to announce and tell you about Uncover, a retreat to create the life of your dreams. Uncover is a three-day retreat being hosted by One Idea Away. I'm going to be there leading and facilitating the retreat along with IPEC founder and best-selling author Bruce Schneider. We've secured the beautiful Asilomar Conference Grounds in California, just a 90-minute ride from the Bay Area, for January 18th through the 20th. And then we're going to be at the Garrison Institute in New York, just 50 miles north of the city, sitting atop the bluffs of the Hudson River on March 29th through the 31st. In this retreat, we're going to guide you through the Uncover process. You can actually learn more about that in the book, Uncovering the Life of Your Dreams by Bruce Schneider. And you're going to learn and experience a variety of mindfulness activities, share and connect as a community, and learn through practices and dialogue in a supportive and, yes, judgment-free zone. You see, this is about closing the gap between who you know yourself to be and how you're currently showing up in life. You see, that gap is part of the tension that any of us can feel in our hearts and minds, because you know there's something more for you to experience, to enjoy, to share, and to contribute. You may feel as if who you are is covered up by your responsibilities and circumstances and priorities, and we don't want to see anyone lose any more years of their lives not being who they fully and truly are. It's time for that to end, and over these 3 days it will. You will uncover your personal path to happiness, freedom, and aligning with your true desires. I cannot wait to meet you in person. I can't wait to spend the time with you over these 3 days. It's going to be an extraordinary experience. Just go to oneideaaway.com/retreat. That's oneideaaway.com/retreat. I promise you, you will never forget this experience. So one of the greatest obstacles to change, to success even, can be found in a slightly unlikely place. It can be found in money. It's interesting because I've spoken with clients and coaches about this for years, because money brings up so many blocks and fears and biases and stresses. And to me, those are actually all good things. Because when they come up, it brings awareness to what's really going on for ourselves. So we can address it. We can do something about it. So today, we're going to talk about that not so often talked about subject, at least not in social circles, and that's money. We're going to talk a bit about what it reveals and how it's actually a source of personal growth, not just material gain, and how in understanding money and our relationship to money, we can actually begin to unlock a more powerful life, an even more powerful version of ourselves. And so to do that, as our guest today, we have Meriflor Toneatto, and she's the author of Money, Manifestation, and Miracles. As the CEO and founder of Power with Soul, she specializes in helping ambitious women entrepreneurs, professionals, and leaders to reach financial prosperity and success while fulfilling their social promise in the world. We're going to talk about that social promise as well. Her work has been featured internationally in media outlets like Yahoo Finance, Washington Post, International Business Times, the LA Times, and many, many more. And with that, Meriflor, thank you so much for joining us on One Idea Away.
I am so excited to be with you, Lou. I'm very grateful to have this opportunity for us to have this very, very interesting conversation about money.
Outstanding. You know, one of the things that really kind of got my attention right at the very beginning of the book is that you did your dedication is to the reader. And as you say, it's to claim your wealth and rise as a force for good in the world. And I'm curious about this because I'm seeing in some of what's out there inside of the professional fields, entrepreneurial fields, I'm seeing a bit of a dichotomy. These two different camps
are forming, one which emphasizes more of the wealth for the sake of lifestyle, and lifestyle with freedom truly at the center of it, not just material gain and accumulation. And then the other I see emphasizing wealth as a force for good, as you talk about. And that to me is leading to things like the rise of social entrepreneurship and conscious capitalism, which I think you even speak on. And so I'm just kind of curious that in terms of when you look out there at the ethos, at the culture of things that are shifting around out there, what do you think explains the rise of some of these views and these two different avenues that, that seem to be popping up a lot?
Well, first of all, Luke, yes, the book, when, as soon as you open the book, the dedication is for the reader to claim their wealth and rise as a force for good. And I do see exactly what you're talking about, this two camps, if you will, as you've described it, with creating wealth for the sake of lifestyle, entrepreneurship, and then, you know, the social aspect of it in terms of social consciousness, using money for good. And really where this book is actually trying to be is in the middle. Because what this book is trying to do, it's trying to bring those two pieces together. And that conversation is happening through money, which is mostly still a taboo conversation in social situations, right? And I think it's really from the awareness aspect of it. So this book is saying that let's not be afraid of money. Let's change that old story of that the root of all evil is money. And let's use it. Yes. And that's still, you know, handed down from generation to generation. But let's use it as a force for good. Because we as coaches, as entrepreneurs, as change agents, we know that if you've got a big message and you've got a big purpose and a big platform, money is often going to be needed to get you to achieve that, to help you along your way. And so what this book is trying to do is to actually merge that. Yes, you can definitely have both. You can be spiritual and rich at the same time. You can be wealthy and have a great lifestyle. And then you can leverage that wealth to for humanity and to help humanity and move forward. So this is where that intersect is coming forward. And I love that you've really isolated that nuance in the book. So thank you.
Absolutely. And let's go a little further on this, because I'm also curious about how you stepped out of where you were and moved into the path that you're going in. Because I had a guest, it was actually not that long ago, Beth Linderbaum, and she very specifically spoke to this idea of the rise of both kind of the entrepreneur and the freelancer, as well as even those that are, they're still, you know, following traditional employment, but they're kind of moving from job to job every few years, looking at as their kind of their next gig of how they're going to move on and what they're going to do next. And I'm kind of curious, because I think there's a lot of people who would like to pursue more of that path that combines the passion and the mission with the profitability, with the lifestyle that they're looking for, and yet they don't make that shift. They don't move out of it. They don't step out of what they've traditionally done. So I'm curious a little bit about kind of your own journey of where it began for you. What was life like, and what did you ultimately need to face to step out and go out and do this type of work, to be on your own in the world?
Well, you know, it's one of these situations, Luke, where we teach best what we most need to learn. So for me, it started in my early 20s. I found myself in a really challenging marriage, which I left, and I had a 4-month-old baby girl to support. And we were living from paycheck to paycheck. And I remembered being really, really anxious about money. And then I remembered thinking, and I had no reason to believe that this would happen at that moment, is that if I was ever in a position to help empower someone, especially a woman with around money, that I would do it. But I never knew what that was going to look like. And, you know, over the years, I had reinvented myself. I climbed the corporate ladder and had a great leadership position that always had a social impact connected to it, because I always wanted to do good. And as I was becoming wealthy and abundant. And then I realized that my inner restlessness kept thinking, you know, I really want to learn and experience this whole freedom of being an entrepreneur, but using it and leveraging my platform, all the experiences I've had, into doing good and helping others to realize their own dreams and their successes. And so when I took the leap and became an entrepreneur, I started to see that when I was helping others, sooner or later, the conversation would turn to money. Mm-hmm. And especially for women, it seemed to be the thing that could hold them back, is that, oh, I'm going to give up because, you know, this is going to require money and I just don't have that. And so I guess my dream isn't going to come true, kind of thing. Right. And so I saw that actually as the tool or the lens for me to get to what was really holding the individual back, what was really happening. So money was just the lens. Yeah. And so using that as the tool, I really, and then for me, figuring out how this whole thing works of having money, being wealthy and doing good, then I really wanted to create that platform for people to be the difference and to claim their wealth and rise as a force for good. And so that is my mission. That is what I'm doing now. And it could be one coach, one entrepreneur, one person transitioning from the corporate to the entrepreneurial. It could be that. And it's, you know, the ripple effect starts to happen.
So I want to talk about that lens that money begins to open up. But just before we do that, I do want to acknowledge one thing, and that's the restlessness that you were feeling where you were before you made that transition. Because I think that's, you know, when we all kind of scan back in our lives of where we are, what we're feeling at any given time, that ability to start to identify what you're feeling, what's really kind of going on for you, you're going to start to recognize certain signs. Restlessness is one of those really, really great signs that can lead you deeper. It can lead you to a deeper inquiry of what's really going on. Why am I restless? What is it that I believe that I want to have right now that I don't have? You know, what is it I'm restless for? And so just to take note and to observe some of the signs that are starting to pop up for you so that you can go into the inquiry, and we're going to get into some of these types of inquiry specifically around the lens of money. But I just I want to point that out so that people don't lose those opportunities when things start to arise. So for you, it's something you wanted to add to that?
Yeah. You know, the other piece of that is that restlessness. There's also another thing, because I waited too long when I felt that restlessness. I waited another 3 years, right? Mm-hmm. Because I was just like, oh my gosh, you know, I had the corner office overlooking the lake, you know? So it was like people are thinking, oh no. And I was listening to everybody else. But you know what took me out, Luke? Yeah. Burnout. I ended up, my body gave out. My body said, you know what, if you're not listening, we're going to create a situation where it's going to take you out, and then you got to do some soul searching.
Yeah.
And so that can also happen too. It could also start to come in the form of symptoms.
Well, for people. You're absolutely right. And unfortunately, I hear that scenario a lot more often than I hear somebody recognizing some of the signs and looking at it more closely. I can speak personally to the fact that I've encountered that burnout for myself in my own career, and at times within, you know, the many, many, many different clients and students that I've had the great fortune of working with, because I think you describe it really well. When we get to that point in life, and you describe it as, you know, the corner office, we're comfortable. And so the idea of completely disrupting that, oh my gosh, I mean, come on. It's like, wait, I've worked for so long to get here. I'm going to completely upend it. And so I'm curious, because I think one of the things that prevents people, actually not one of the things, one of the major things that prevents people from making that shift is part of that comfort is money. And so what is it that we need to start looking at then? How is it that money can be a lens into what's really going on for ourselves, so that we can do a little bit of that deeper work and maybe find a way of making these shifts a lot earlier than waiting 3, 4, 5 years until that burnout really is an issue and we don't have a choice. We have to do something.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point. This whole thing is an inner journey. We have sometimes we forget that we have this beautiful thing called intuition. And we sometimes don't tune into that. And, you know, I've been guilty of that myself. And it's really, you know if you are not living on purpose. Yeah. Because your heart, you just feel contained. You feel like on a day-to-day basis, it's like this cycle where, you know, you get up, you take a shower, you get dressed, you go to work, and, you know, then you come home, have late dinner, and then the cycle starts again. You know, if you're not living life with purpose. And one of the other things about that is that you can look at patterns with money because of the fact that money is actually a mirror to how we are in other parts of our lives. So for instance, if you've seen some people who are very anxious about money, who are, oh my gosh, I might not have enough. And there's always this kind of anxiety filled thoughts around money. Chances are that person is also anxious about their career, other parts of their lives, and they act in the same way. Yes. And this is so fascinating because there's actually an exercise in the book where I talk about really getting to the core of taking stock of your relationship with money, like going back as far as understanding how money was talked about in your household when you were growing up with your parents, because we can take some of those beliefs and we use that in the lens of in our world of how abundant or scarce the world is. And that's not even talking about money itself. That's right. Just now a belief in a lens that many people will go and look for that. And so sometimes that can really stop people from getting out there and fully living, serving, and having that quality and meaning in their lives. And I'm here to say that you and I, you know, we know that. And despite that, having this fear of, you know, disrupting the comfort, we knew that something even better was going to be on the other side because it was going to make our soul really come to life.
Mm. And I do want to get to that something even better. I want to actually get specifically to that soul promise in a little bit as well. Before we do, mm-hmm. I want to go a little further on this idea of the kind of the background of the money story, because where you're going with this in terms of the patterns that money can reveal to us about, you know, how we're showing up in various aspects of our lives, I think is a really, really important one. And to exactly what you're saying, when money is that mirror, it can provide us so much insight as to what's really going on. So maybe you could give us a little bit of that, you know, that background, whether from your own story or from some of your clients, of what does that money story look like? What are some of the origins of that money story within our family? And how does that carry through? How does that then manifest later in our lives?
Sure. I've got this really great story, Luke, and it's from this woman who was growing up with she has two older brothers and she's the third child. And every week their father would give them allowance. And she started to notice that she would get less than her brothers. Mm. And then so she asked, "Dad, why am I getting less than they are?" And her dad said, "Don't worry, they need more money because they're going to be the breadwinners. But you're not. You're going to marry somebody and they'll take care of you." And so that story framed how she thought and how she was in the world. And she told me that she habitually under-earned, and she's a highly educated woman, mm-hmm. habitually under-earned until one day she thought, "Hang on, that was that story, I don't have to live by that story. That story doesn't have to define me." Because, you know, she was trying not to make more than her husband at some point. It was really, really, it really got to her in terms of the fact that she loved her father. She really looked up to her father. So he must be right, you know. And so then that kind of realization for her is that I don't need this story. I can create a new story right now, a story that is way more empowering. And that's how she started to turn the tide of this mm-hmm. perpetual under-earning.
Yeah. You know, it's amazing how things that can be so simple in our past and things that our parents or teachers or whomever may have thought really nothing about because that was just part of society. It was part of culture maybe at the time. And these simple things plant these fairly powerful seeds that stay with us. And for everybody, you know, when you hear these things, obviously it sounds simple to explain some of this now because it's, you know, 2020 hindsight. It's so much easier for us to look back and explain this, right? But to take that time to go through these types of exercises to explore, wait a minute, what was my family's pattern with money? How did we use it? Was it, did we hold tight? Did we cling to it because we were always worried and anxious we were going to lose it? Or did we spend it at times just so we could feel good and get a little bit of that rush to replace something that maybe we weren't getting somewhere else? So to think about the different ways that money was used and the story that was attached there, because in our reaction to it, and I'm curious, Meriflor, how this, you've also seen this play out, because I've seen it play out, to me, I've seen it play in two ways. Primarily, one is exactly as you said, we adopt that money pattern, or the alternative is we completely rebel against it. Whether it was a good pattern or not, we just rebel against it because we're not going to do it that way. And we just need to be conscious of what this is, right?
Oh, exactly. Yes, you're absolutely right. I mean, it depends on the dynamics, right? And the individual. Yep. But the rebelling piece of it could be is fascinating too, because that's happened. And sometimes it goes so much the other way that people become so much of get into a lot of debt sometimes with money, and sometimes it can lead to even gambling problems, right?
Absolutely.
So we've seen all of these different ranges, and at the heart of it though is that we as individuals, it's an inner journey in terms of creating enduring wealth for ourselves. And I mean that from a holistic sense. I mean that in the sense that it's not just financial, but holistic wealth in terms of wealth in all areas of your life. Do you have richness in your health? Do you have richness in your career? Are you doing what you love? Do you have passion for that? What are your relationships like? And so this is what makes us really come alive as well. And then when you've got that, the money that can come with that as well, then you're starting to live your truth. Then when you have that, you're able then to pay it forward.
And it's a wonderful frame for us to be able to think about the holistic picture of money, because what we're saying is, how is it that we are rich and enriched in all of these different areas of our life? And when we look at, you know, these different aspects, our relationship and our career, not just our money and even our health, and we look at it in terms of that, of how rich and enriched are we in these areas, again, it starts to reveal some really interesting patterns that are there. Now, Meriflor, one of the things which I thought was really interesting in, as we start to discover some of these patterns and these stories and everything else, the base starting point that you talk about that's part of this major money transformation of some of that inner work is around the idea of alignment. And I was hoping you could speak more to this idea of alignment, because this is also the center of a lot of the work that I do and some of what we propagate through One Idea Away. So I'm really curious for your take, your perspective of what are we aligning to? What is that alignment all about?
First of all, I love that question. Love, love, love. Because this is it. We are all of the success formula, all of this work that we're all doing to really become the highest version of ourselves. Every time we release something, we are getting into alignment and into our purpose, our mission, our passion, and our highest sense of being. And when we can do that from that place, so that means we're shifting mindsets. We are releasing beliefs that are no longer serving us. We are releasing actions that haven't really been good for our higher good and for others. And then when we get into that alignment, then that's when everything starts to happen in our lives with grace and ease. Because that is like my litmus test, is I know just from experience and being so aware of how I think and how I am in the world, is that when something is meant to happen and it's like that opportunity that opens up for you, there's so much grace and ease with that, because there's no pushing. Because when you're pushing really, really hard, there's still resistance there. And being in alignment is there is no resistance. You know, you're just offering yourself up to you know, the universe and the opportunities that start to come your way. And you are going to get on the path to whatever your goal and mission is. And if that's all in alignment, there's really, it's just really flow is the best way I can describe it. It's just flow.
So for everybody, I want you guys to think about for a moment. I'm going to use another word here as well, maybe to help you picture this. Think of that individual that maybe you've known in your life, maybe you knew them, you know, very well, maybe you just knew them for a fleeting moment, but they were completely congruent, meaning they were fully aligned, right? So fully aligned with their values and their purpose and their confidence in who they were. Now, Meriflor, I think you use a great phrase, great, wonderful phrase and qualities of grace and ease. And what I also want to extract from that is that when you have that grace and ease and that just innate calm confidence that's there, number one, that stems from the alignment, it stems from the congruency that's there, but you also tend to perform better, you're more productive, you tend to be more motivated. That type of personality is more contagious, which makes you more attractive to people. And so when you get all of that going on, there's a reason, there's many reasons that all of a sudden things do start to come about. Things do start to fall in front of you. It's not, you know, just magic, although I think there's a little magic to it, but yes. It's not just magic. There's a lot that goes along with it, but it begins with exactly what you're talking about, which is this idea of getting into alignment with who you are and, you know, why do you want to do what you do? Why do you want to live this life?
Mm-hmm. Yes, beautiful. And thank you for adding congruence, because that is absolutely the right word.
So
and when we live from that place, I mean, we can make so many change and do so much good.
So what's one or two things that we can do as individuals and some of the listeners that are out there to begin to peel away at the things that we're not, the things that are not working for us? How do we start to do that so we can get to the level of clarity that you talk about in the book, which is that clarity of what are our real values? What really truly is the purpose that we have? How do we get down to that?
Yes. Well, first of all, it's choice and intention. Mm. So we always have this beautiful thing called choice, and we get to choose. If we know that there's that inner restlessness, or we're not feeling happy in our lives, we can then start to turn inward and choose to say, I'm going to be really working on this to see what it is that I really want. What is it that comes alive or that makes me come alive? And so this book, for instance, has chock full of tools and tips and strategies to help you go through that inward journey. And then when you have that, then you can start to set an intention of how it is that you want to live your life, how you want to be in the world, how you want to contribute to the world, and how you want your life to look like. So again, it's looking at it from a holistic sense. And then when you are starting this inner journey, which I think, you know, most people try not to do that, because we really have to look inward and we have to say, okay, you know, I've got to take 100% responsibility for everything that's in my life. And sometimes that is not always, you know, rosy colored glasses for people. And it's a lot of work, right? So sometimes people will say, oh my God, I don't want to do that. And that's why we as coaches, that's why we're here in service, because we know what that journey is like. And when you start to do that, every single thing that you learn, that gives you more clarity. Clarity gives you more alignment, and alignment gives you that congruence. Mm.
So one of the things that also begins to unfold at that point, and I think you did a really great job of speaking to this, is that as you start to get that clarity, you get this picture, you get this vision of where you would like to be, of what that may look like in terms of what the work may look like and what relationships may look like and the overall lifestyle and the passion, the purpose, all of these things, you start to see it. The next thing that's going to come up, though, is you're going to see which beliefs buy into that and believe that that's possible. And then you're also going to see the beliefs start to pop up that start to say, oh yeah, that's a dream. You're not getting there. And I'm curious, what do you do with that? Because you talk about this from that standpoint of investigating mindset and beliefs. So what do we do when we may see this great vision, and then all of a sudden the other beliefs start coming out that really start talking us down away from it?
Well, that is a perfect conversation for the inner critic always comes out, right? We all have an inner critic. It's this, it's this voice that says to us, who do you think you are? Do you think you can actually do this? And whatever the tapes that play in our head. Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting because I talk about the fact in the book is that mindset is a prelude to action. Yeah. Because, you know, that our starting point, we think that our starting point has to do with our actions. It's actually what we thought first that came to be into leading into that action. And one of the things around this, it's always around shifting your mindset. And it's actually easier than we think. And it's like building a muscle. It's going to be a little bit of a ping pong match in your head for a little while. But let's say you come up with that vision and that dream. And then right away, your inner critic and your self fears and doubts come up. And at that moment, you can actually choose to actively replace that thought and say, what next thought can I reach for that can make me feel expansive? And maybe it's just a thought that says, why not? Mm-hmm. If all things are possible, why not me? You know? And what you're looking for, so you're looking for the belief and the emotion need to match in that you feel more expansive. It feels exciting and it feels like it's light. And then you go and you start to think, okay, so if I have this feeling about this, what does that mean? What could I do with that? How do I stay with that emotion? And I do have a lot of exercises in the book, and one of them is to befriend your inner critic. Because your inner critic is never going to leave. There's a way of befriending it, though, where it could become your ally instead.
Yeah.
And many of us who have been on the journey have done that. And on occasion, I mean, my inner critic is on a really amazing vacation in Maui at the moment. and she's been there for a while, actually, and she doesn't want to come back. So, so and if we can look at it too, look from a sense of humor.
Yeah.
It can lighten so many things up because, you know, we have to look at it from that sense, and things start to, come together more quickly for us. But this is it. This book, I've written it for that purpose, for, you know, helping people to really get to the heart of what may be holding them back and then doing something about it, because the fact is the world needs your special gift and what you're here to share.
So 2 points I just wanted to expand on. Number one is I really appreciate bringing humor into this, because as human beings, we are some funny creatures. We do some really strange things. And I talked about it years ago. It was a little chapter of an ebook that I'd written, that we all need to get intimately familiar with our own weird little worlds, because we all have them. All right. And it resides right between our ears. And, but we're funny. We just do some funny things. And it's when we believe the story that's there, and we believe that that's the only way it can be, and that it's gospel, it's fact, this is what it is. That's when all of a sudden we get caught up and we forget that we're in this much bigger picture. We feel like we're in the movie, not watching the movie. And we want to be able to step back. And when we do step back, that sense of humor just comes through, because we can see the funny things that we do to ourselves. The one thing, though, that I did also want to come back to, because this was so simply and beautifully put, is to look for where the belief and the emotion match. Because when the belief and the emotion match, and they match in a way that moves you forward, because it's aligned, it's lighter, it's expansive, as Meriflor, you put it, that's such a beautiful way to tune in to what's the best way forward for yourself. Because in some instances, it may be a big shift and a big step, which is great, but it may be something very small. But even if it's small, if it's congruent, that builds momentum. And it's in those small steps and those small moments that the bigger momentum ultimately will come from. And that's such a great way of tuning in to when the belief and the emotion match in a way that move you forward. It feels lighter and expansive. It's a beautiful cue for everybody to be able to look at. So, Meriflor, there's one thing that you raise in the book, and I wanted to use this to kind of bring our conversation together today, is to I guess in two steps. Number one is you talk about social promise. And I'm curious if you could elaborate a little bit more on what you mean by social promise and why this is kind of at the core of what we're all sort of drawn to and what we're really truly after.
Mm-hmm, sure. So social promise is really about doing good and doing well in business and making, leveraging that profits and the money to then pay it forward to any social issues that we may be really interested in. Or if not social issues, making a difference, making an impact in the world. And I find that as entrepreneurs, as coaches, and as change agents, we do this work because, I mean, we love it for ourselves and it does serve us, no question about it. But the human spirit, we love to be of service. We love to be, you know, to help people succeed. And this is a way that we can use business as a force for good. And we're seeing this a lot, like conscious capitalism, the work of John Mackey, for instance. We were seeing so much of that. But I think that in this day and time that we are right now in the world, where there's so much need actually to bring love and goodness back to humanity, I think this is really calling on us as change agents to really step up and do that in our work too. And you know what? We can use even the spiritual tithing, donating your 10% of your income to causes and issues that we believe in. It could start as simple as that.
Yeah. So you ask, as part of this conversation in the book, you ask just again another really simple question, but such an important one. And it's, why does your business exist? And you could also ask that as, you know, why do you continue to choose the job or the career that you have and are pursuing as well? And, you know, for this, when I think about it, and just to expand on this a little bit for everybody, is when we talk about why does your business exist, it's not simply to fulfill a certain need in the marketplace. It's not to simply pay the bills. Yes, those are things that we do because of the work that we do, whether it's job, business, or otherwise. But why does it really exist? When we think about One Idea Away in this podcast, the platform, yes, we do these things, we provide certain services and information, but why do we do it? We want people to be in greater connection with who they truly are. Because when you are, you have more peace and you have more joy and you find more fulfillment in your life. And that leads to what we think is going to be a more peaceful and fun world. That's why we actually do what we do, right? And so I bring all of that up, Meriflor, because I wanted to ask you of why is this the work that you do and why is it personally best for you?
Well, this is a lifelong mission for me, really, to help people to let their prosperity reflect the good that they contribute to the world. It's as simple as that, because of the fact that I understand we have so many hang-ups around money, but money in of itself is just an object. It's what we can do with the money that can say so much more. And we can actually, and many people won't ever talk about this, but money can equal love. You know, some people could go running hearing that, thinking, what is she talking about? But if you really think about it, and we talk about the fact that if you're, people are sometimes spiritual saying, oh, it's not about the money. I don't need the money. And that could be true. But listen, Mother Teresa also said that it takes a checkbook to change the world. And we cannot, it's so interesting that money interweaves with our lives on a daily basis. So let's use it for our highest good and for the highest good of others. And I'm doing this work, my greater why, if you will, is because that I think that if we know how to claim our wealth, use it for our highest good, and then be of service to others, imagine the kind of world the peace and the harmony that we can actually have in the world. And there's so many people that are so interested right now, entrepreneurs, thought leaders, so interested right now in being that person, in living that life, and being that service and contribution. And I think, you know, there are no coincidences. That is the very first line in my book. And anybody who's listening to us here, that means it's a call to action for your soul.
Meriflor, I want to thank you so much for just sharing your energy, your insights, your passion, your purpose, your mission with everybody here at One Idea Away today.
Oh, thank you so much. What a beautiful blessing to have this conversation with you, Luke. You're fantastic, and thank you for all that you are doing.
Thank you, Meriflor. You know, for everybody, I guess there's just a couple things that I want to leave you with. One is where Meriflor was just wrapping up, and that's there are no coincidences, meaning pay attention to the synchronicities. They are all around you. There are some extraordinary things happening in this life. Open your eyes wide and begin to look for them, because I promise you they are there. I also want to come back to the dedication of the book to the reader and to you, the listener, which is to claim your wealth and rise as a force for good in the world. And I'm going to say that just one slight tweak, a slight adjustment in how I'm going to say that. And it's a little more blunt. It's going to be to get over yourself, meaning get over the issues, the blocks that are there, do the hard work, face those types of things. Why? Because there are people out there waiting for you that you can help, that you can serve. And the first person you're going to do that with is you. So once again, everybody, I want to thank you for dropping in on One Idea Away. And until we meet again, continue to enjoy the journey. Hey, as this episode is wrapping up, you may be asking yourself, what's next? Well, what's next? I hope that you've been joining in on the monthly live cast that we do for the One Idea Away community. You see, every single month, we gather some incredible guests that are talking about the types of transitions that they've made or are even in the midst of making to create a happier life, to create a life that's more aligned to who they truly are. So we're talking about happiness and purpose. We're talking about community. We're talking about how do we have that modern day success, meaning how do we succeed in our happiness, our well-being, our quality of life, while also making a great living, making the difference in the contributions that we are each meant to make. So when you get involved in the monthly live cast, you can ask some questions of our guests, you can participate with some of the other community members and the ongoing chat that just seems to explode as we get into these deeper conversations throughout the whole hour that we do this. So the only way though that you can get these special episodes is when you register for them. It is free, but you got to register to get involved and continue the conversation, as we're always talking about. So just hop on over to oneideaaway.com/livecast. That's oneideaaway.com/livecast. Join us there, get involved in the conversation, get involved in the community. I can't wait to continue the conversation with you. Thanks for listening to today's episode. If you really enjoyed it, do me a favor, let us know. You can keep the conversation going and send us a message on our Facebook page, which is simply One Idea Away. Go ahead and tag me in the post, or even just direct messages. Also, I would be incredibly grateful if you could share this episode along with someone that you believe could benefit from hearing the ideas and the messages that we got into. That's pretty much why we do this. So you can just go ahead and share it from your app or email it along, whatever works for you. The point is to share, to talk, to discuss, and keep the dialogue going, because it's in those conversations that ideas can take hold and create profound shifts in perspective. That's what allows us to live life more fully, deeply, and consciously. As always, we would love to see you post a review for the podcast in iTunes or whichever app you're using. And until next time, remember, you're never more than one idea away from a whole new reality. This is Luke Iorio and One Idea Away, signing off.